to rest. The kids are playing up downstairs. Sister's saying in her sleep. Brother's got a date to keep. He can't hang around. And it's usually quite loud. Our mum, she's so house proud. Nothing ever slows her down, and a mess is not allowed. Our house, in the middle of our street. Our house, in the middle of our street. Our house, in the middle of our street.
Something tells you that you've got to move
in the middle of our. Father gets up late for work.
Hey, welcome. I'm glad you're here. I mean, gosh, all this sickness going around, you escaped, hopefully. So be sure and wash your hands all week long so you can be here on Sunday, you know. So I'm glad you're here, and I really literally prayed for you. If you're anything like me, man, you need more of God. And man, I'm going to tell you something. We've been in this series called Our House, and it's been pretty fun to study for it. I hope it's been applicable to your life. I think it always is, if you'll let it. We've just been looking at, man, how do we view God's house? This is God's house, and hopefully it's your house, okay? And so we're looking at this, and this is kind of the scripture we kind of been going off of every week, and this is what it says. This is Jesus talking, so it's very important. People leaned in to hear this. I hope you will too. It says, anyone who listens to my teaching and follows it is wise. It's just like a person that builds their house on solid rock. It goes on to talk about, you know, hey, when you do that, when you build it on solid rock, winds and waves can come, but it's going to stand. But if you build it on sand, things that don't matter, because that's real easy to do. There's a temptation to do it. It's easy to do it if you're just coasting in life to build your house. The most important thing in your life is the house you live in. And if you build it on sand, the Bible says when those same winds and waves come, look, it'll come crashing down. And so when Jesus taught this, he said this, verse 28 says, when Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching. Absolutely amazed. And listen, I'm convinced that God brought you here, and he never intends for us to leave the way we came. And that's just how we treat his house, as we come and leave changed. So I'm going to pray for us, and we'll get started. Father, thank you, Lord, for your word in advance. God, thank you for this series already. God, and what it, the conversations that it's created, the decisions, Lord, to make your house a priority, Lord. That is our goal, is to consider your house our house. And so, God, thank you for people, Lord, able to make a day. Lord, people on our heart that are sick, God, they've got the flu, they've got stomach bugs, they've got the crud and the cold. So, God, we pray for them, Lord. We hope that they feel encouraged, Lord, that they understand and realize and are confident that we are praying for them, God. God, I also know of situations people are facing this week. Lord, help people to leave here, Lord, knowing that you are with them. So, God, just thank you for your word already. In Jesus' name, everybody say amen. I'm glad you made it. And so, God does want to change us. And I want to concentrate on this. Let this first verse kind of get us started. It's kind of be the direction we're going. And this is what it says in John 2:17. It says that his disciples remembered that it is written, zeal or passion for your house will consume me. And here's what they're talking about. This is on the heels of Jesus had just come into the temple, into his Father's house. Okay, this is a representation of who God is. A church is when we meet like this. And when he went into the temple courts, people in there doing some things they shouldn't. They were buying and trading, gypping poor people because they were coming, they had to bring a sacrifice, and they would sell it in the temple courts. And Jesus didn't like it. And it's like he took off his belt, folded it in half, and started swinging at people. That's exactly what the Bible says that he was doing. He was angry. And they were saying, good gosh, look at Jesus go. Man, he really has a zeal for his Father's house. He has a passion for it. And that's what they remembered, what these disciples were remembering, is something way back in the Old Testament in Psalm 69, verse 9. is that this guy was going through, he was writing songs about how all of his enemies were coming against him and how hard he had it. But God, my zeal for your house is what gets me through. Okay? And so that's what we're going to go through. His disciples remember, people that followed Jesus, they remembered that this verse, zeal for your house will consume me. And so I know for a fact we've got some really passionate people in our church that they're really consumed by things. And when you're passionate about something, you're consumed by it. That means you think about it, you talk about it, you dream about it. Okay, so listen, write this down. Whatever you're passionate about, you're consumed by it. Whatever that is, it could be God's house, but it could be a lot of other things. When you're passionate about it, you're consumed by it. You're thinking about it, dreaming about it, talking about it. And I was thinking this week that, man, we have some pretty weird passions, even amongst us here, and I don't know if you've noticed that, but people become passionate and consumed by some pretty weird things. Now, some of these are just my opinions, okay? It's okay. You can be wrong, and we still love you at this church, but these aren't judgments. They're just observations. I started thinking, man, what are some people I know that I know them intimately that I can make an example? I'd love for you to have some visuals. If you're like me, I need visual stuff going on. Have you ever met a cat person? Cat people? Maybe you're one. You're probably sitting beside one if you're not one. Okay? And it's okay. One or two cats, man. Three or four. Okay? I'm talking about cat people. I'm talking about people that are consumed with all things cat. They're talking about kitty litter. They're talking about kitty treats. All this stuff. And that's just what cat people do. They even have little cat quotes. I don't know if you've been on the internet in a while to see those. But I got a real special friend here, and his name's Oscar. And he's passionate and consumed with cats. Once a year, he gets this picture made with his cat. And I don't know. He's just all about cats. And cat people, you know cat people, they even have their own little language. Their voice changes. They say, kitty, kitty, kitty. Kitty cat language. And so this is Oscar. And let me tell you, Oscar is also seriously passionate about helping our church get it off the ground with a Hispanic ministry. And so, yeah, he can't hear it. If you clap loud enough, he might hear it. He's working with kids. But he's also, I went to his house to talk to him about this ministry, and he gave him a way to go purchase some food in Your Glow food program that would Hispanics might benefit from, and we talked. So I went to his house, and I walked in the door, and there were all these cats. I took a picture of it. I don't know. They looked like they were having a meeting. The mayor of Kitty City was there, and they all looked at me like I wasn't supposed to be there, but... And so I just, you know, when you're passionate about something, you're consumed by it, right? And that was Oscar. And so I started thinking about just the area that we live in. You can be, you know, passionate about different things. And I got another buddy who is all into NASCAR, really passionate about it. I found an old picture of him. You might recognize him. That's our buddy Carl. Is Carl in the house? Oh, okay. We like that haircut better, Carl. And, you know, Carl likes to invite our family over. We appreciate him for he does it a lot, but for Christmas. And I just kind of took a tour around his house. And, you know, these people are obsessed with NASCAR. They got their cars everywhere. They're signed by their favorite driver and all that. And he's got these jackets and all that type of thing. And you need to ask him about he's a Dale Earnhardt fan, so when after church, not now, he's got a number 3 for Dale Earnhardt's right here. Just ask him about it. He might be too embarrassed to show you, but you know, whatever you're most passionate about, you're probably consumed by it, right? I talked speaking to Carl, he had 2 girls. He said, if I had a boy, I was gonna name Dale Jr. And so he looks pretty mad right now. I hope he doesn't beat me up. But the disciples are saying this about Jesus. They're saying, man, this guy is passionate, and he is consumed by the house of God. It's the most important thing to him. So I'm going to talk about this phrase, the house of God. And man, as followers, we should be as passionate as Jesus is about his church. And my goal of even doing this series, starting this series and going through it, would be, listen, that you would value like you never had before God's house. Church is important. And it's one of the first things. There's already a bunch of suckers that have bought into the idea that church just isn't important. I can do this at home. I don't need church. There's too much drama, and it is. I feel pretty blessed at this church. I gotta be honest with you. There's not a lot of drama happening unless y'all just ain't telling me about it. But it can happen and does, right? And what better target of the enemy than it would be the church? But don't let anybody talk you out of the importance of church. Sometimes we dismiss it or minimize it. Man, it's so important. His disciples saying, man, this is so important to him. He's obsessed with it. So I want to talk about this phrase, house of God, and it's in a whole lot of places in the Bible. That's what it makes it so important. That's another pattern. As a church, when we're studying God's word, we're looking for patterns a lot, and this is one of them, talking about the house of God. And I think that this helps understand that a little better, and it's Paul of the New Testament. He had a major encounter with Jesus, right? And his life was just radically changed, and he wrote most of the New Testament, it seems. And he kind of gives us a definition of the house of God. So watch for it here in 1 Timothy chapter 3. It'll be on the screen for you. It says, although I hope to come to you soon, what he's saying, I'm writing. He would write people that were starting churches and they were gathering. And he would write them letters to encourage them and instruct them. And he says, although I hope to be coming to you soon, I'm super busy and I'm on my way. I love you and all that type of thing. I'm writing you with these instructions so that if I'm delayed, if something comes up, you will know how people ought to conduct themselves in God's household. And it says, which is the church of the living God. So God's household is the church, the pillar and the foundation of the truth. It's saying this is where you get the truth. This is important. It needs to be steady. It needs to be stable. We need to meet every time. Oh, I think it's drizzling outside. I think we ought to cancel church today on my end. I'm trying. If it's just short of safety, I mean, we're going to keep the door. Because what I understand and what I hope you understand from your end is, I mean, that has to be a steady thing, ongoing. Because that's where truth is received and understanding happens. So Paul's helping us out. He's trying to get us to understand what God's house is, okay? And the church is God's house. Write that down, as simple as it sounds. The church is God's house. And I want to be clear on this because God doesn't live in a house by any structure that humans make, but when we gather in a facility like this, no matter where this is, we are the church. This is the church. When we come together like that. So the building became the house of God when we came into it. Does that make sense?
Yeah, right.
So you're in God's house right now. It's not just some random building. It's not just entertainment in here. It's God's house. And because it's so full of truth and so important to him and to us, right? That's why he's so passionate about it. And in a different letter that Paul was writing, he says, this is Ephesians. In Ephesians 5:25, it says, husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her. Okay, so it's really important. He loved the church. He loves the church. And so and he proved it by dying for her. I love how he put it as a her. In other words, this is a sacred assembly. This is a holy gathering. It's a holy meeting when we do this, right? And so this whole thing's a really, really big deal when we do this. And we can't take it lightly. And he loves it so much. He's so passionate about it that he gave his life for her. And that means us. He gave his life. So when he died on the cross, it's so the church, our gathering together, could be established. So, because we see this phrase, house of God, a lot, I want to take you to the point of kind of where it originated. And we're going to go all the way back to the Old Testament. We're going to be in Genesis chapter 28, verse 10. And we're going to see this cool story about the house of God. I think you'll like this. It's Genesis 28, 10 through 22, ultimately. It's about Jacob's dream at Bethel. Sometimes you have a little title in your Bible. Jacob, this guy named Jacob's having a dream. It's going to affect all of mankind. It says, meanwhile, Jacob, and he's kind of the main character, left Beersheba and traveled towards Haran. These are important things that had already happened historically that God had to do with. And it's saying he left Beersheba and he's traveling towards Haran. At sundown, he arrived at a good place to set up camp and stop there for the night. Jacob found a stone to rest his head. Isn't that weird? He found a stone to rest his head against and lay down to sleep. He says, this looks good. Now, he must have been dog tired. You ever been just dog tired? Like, man, I could sleep right now. You hand me a pillow. And he didn't even need a pillow. It's weird to have a stone. And so some of our AV team got together and came up with a couple pictures of people who just throw those up there. Yeah. I mean, look at that. That's awesome. I'm going to try that at work. Is there another one? Oh, look at that. Little kids will do that in a heartbeat. One. They'll just pile up and sleep. And one of my kids did that when they were little. I'm glad you picked that one. They just fall asleep. And you thought somebody would come and snatch them up, but they're just balled up somewhere sleeping. And so, man, you know, when you're tired enough, you'll sleep in some crazy places. So it goes on to say in verse 12, as he slept while he was sleeping on this stone, his head on this stone, he dreamed of a stairway that reached from earth up to heaven. Some of your versions say a ladder or something like that, or some gateway. And I always go straight to Led Zeppelin, Stairway to Heaven, right? But this is where that idea came from, is what we're reading about. And it says, and he saw the angels of God going up and down the stairway, okay? So what it's saying is this stairway, and scholars tell us that this is really about Jesus, that he's the stairway to heaven. He's the in-between. Our fallen humanity and heaven is actually Jesus. We find out later. That was just extra. So it goes on to say, verse 13, at the top of the stairway stood the Lord, and he said this is awesome, I am the Lord, the God of your grandfather Abraham and the God of your father Isaac. The ground you are lying on belongs to you. He's giving him blessings here. He says, I'm giving it to you and your descendants. He's talking about blessings. He says, your descendants will be numerous as the dust of the earth. They'll be uncountable, is what he's saying. They will spread out all directions, to the west and the east, to the north and the south, and all the families of the earth will be blessed through you and your descendants. And watch this, because this is important. What's more, on top of that, the cherry on top of this awesome blessing is, I am with you, and I will protect you wherever you go. Now, that's quite the message from God. What God's basically saying is, he says, I'm going to bless you, I'm going to use you, and I'm going to be with you. That's what he's telling him. I'm going to bless you, I'm going to use you, and I'm going to be with you. And that's the message he gave Jacob. But I think it's the same message that we get every single week when we study God's word. I think that's a message for us, is that he's going to bless us and use us and be with us. And I think that's why Jesus is passionate to the point he is consumed by his church, because he knows we're going to get that every single week when we read his words. And I don't know about you, but I need that every week. I don't know if you get hit like I do every week with something, and I need this. And I started thinking about all the, when you share with me, I keep it confidential, but I know that, man, you fill up. These are just some of the things I heard in the past 2 weeks. I'm not good enough. I don't measure up. I don't feel like people care about me. Some of you are haunted by the past. You're overwhelmed with your circumstances. You're worried and anxious and stressed and depressed. That's what we go through every week. But when you come to this house, you hear a message. You expose yourself to the Lord, and he's so faithful to put into us. And we come to the house and hear a message. And his message to us is, man, I love you. I forgive you. I want a relationship with you. You're valuable and you matter. And that's what we get when we come to the house. He says, I want to bless you. And I want to use you. And I want to be with you. So that's why Jesus is so passionate about it. He knows we get that here. Now, Jacob's having this pretty awesome dream here, and I want you to see how it ends, verse 16. It says, then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I wasn't even aware of it. And I thought that was a pretty tragic statement. That's pretty pretty tragic to the Lord's here and I didn't even know it. And a lot of people, they go in and out of churches and they just don't understand that the Lord is there. But he woke up from his sleep. He said, surely the Lord is in this place. And I wasn't even aware. Verse 17 says, but he was also afraid and said, what an awesome place this is. He's talking about the house of God, you'll see in a minute. What an awesome place this is. It is none other than the house of God, the very gateway to heaven. So we get another description of the house of God, the church. And sometimes you'll see temple in the Bible. And he's saying it's awesome. And it's the house of God. And it's the very gateway to heaven. That means between us and heaven, it's important. It's important to God. It's important to Jesus. And the first time we see this phrase being used in Scripture, Jacob went on to name the place. Listen, it's called Bethel. He said, I'm naming this place. It's awesome. I'm going to call it Bethel. And what Bethel means is the house of God. It's awesome. And I understand its significance now. It's between us and heaven. So Jacob was making the same point that the disciples were making. And it says that he was saying that this is a sacred place that God meets with his people. That's why he named it that. I just met God where I am. And I'm going to call this the house of God. And I want you to know that every week, sometimes maybe you're not feeling it. Sometimes you're just disconnected or you weren't here. People every week, even if it's one person, are meeting with God every week when they come here. This is the house of God. And so he called it that. He said, I'm going to call it Bethel. So he says, surely the presence of the Lord. Now he responded to that. He just didn't get that information. Oh, that's awesome to have those blessings. He responded to it. It's important to respond to God's blessings. Okay? Now, I don't know if you've had kids. I've said this before in another context, but if you got kids in your house, enjoy every moment with them. When they're small, they don't mean anything by it when they grow up. But you are the best thing that ever walked. They respond. They respond to you. Man, I remember coming home from work. I'd drive faster on the way home from work because my kids are going to come up and say, Dad! And I'd do something crazy and silly and all that. I enjoyed that because there was response to my presence. Listen, and God wants a response to his presence. I would write that down. God's presence demands a response. And Jacob had a response to the house of God. Watch what he did. The next morning when he got up very early, he took the stone, remember that stone he had rested his head against, and he set it upright as a memorial pillar. He made a pillar. Then he poured olive oil over it. And he's doing stuff. He's responding to God's blessings in this house of God, this Bethel, this place called Bethel. He named the place Bethel, which means house of God, although it was previously called Luz. Now, he changed the name. And maybe you can relate to that. Man, I used to view God's house differently, man. But since we've been in this series, I got totally different. Good job, Richard. That was great. I totally changed the way I look at God's house and this place. Then Jacob made a vow. So he's making pillars. He's pouring olive oil over it. And now he's making a vow. Jacob made this vow. If God will indeed be with me and protect me on this journey, and he will provide for me the food and clothing, if I return safely to my father's home, then the Lord will certainly be my God. He's going to prove himself. And this memorial pillar I have set up will become a place for worshiping God. This is where I'm going to worship God. And I will present to God a tenth. He's doing something else. He responded to more of God's blessings and God's house. It says, I will present to God a tenth of everything he gives me. Everything he gives me. And so here's Jacob's response. If you didn't get that, it's hard to pick it out. I kind of made one slide for it. And this is Jacob's response. Number one, he made a pillar, a reminder or a marker. Man, this is what God did for me. This is where it happened. Okay? He's going to remember it. The other thing is, remember, he poured olive oil over it. That means to, when anytime oil is used, it means to set apart or to consecrate or to become important. And then he made a vow. He made a commitment. Listen, God's house deserves a commitment. I feel like, man, if Jesus would die for the church, that it deserves our commitment to it. And so that's not a guilt or shame. It is a hopefully just like Jacob. just like we've all had to come to the conclusion, how important is God's house? And he changed his mind about it. He said, man, this changes everything. And so he made a vow, a commitment, a declaration. And finally, a tenth. His first. Remember, we said it's not just money. We learned this last week. A tithe is not just money. He says a tenth of everything. A tenth of my time, a tenth of this, a tenth of that. But the first, that's the most important part, is the first, not the leftovers. That shows, God, we trust you, we believe in you. And that's what he was doing. And so I want to jump into this next part, man. We're moving right along. I hope it's a lot in a little bit. You know what I'm saying? I want to jump all over this verse before we go. It's out of the book of Psalms. And now Psalms are music. You can go read the book of Psalms. I mean, you can sit there and read for a while. It tells you a story. I started shedding tears this morning. I was like, And it's just great to follow, man, the emotions that's in it. But the Psalms are expressions, are expressions of the heart made in the spirit of worship. Like, these are my emotions. I'm going to sing about it. I'm going to write a poem about it. And that's what the book of Psalms are. It's about God. It talks about the difficulty we have and who God is and all of our emotions. I think it's awesome. And so, but the Psalm gives us a picture and a promise. Go back and read them. Pick one. I did Psalm 69 today. I could feel this guy aching and hurting, but seeing God in the middle of that. And so what we're going to see here as we read this is a picture and a promise about being God in God's house, planted in God's house, okay? So let's get started on this. Now, before I start this, I want to tell you the definition of righteous. I've been hitting this a lot lately. Now, that word righteous sounds like either in rock and roll bands, righteous, I guess, or that turtle on the Finding Nemo, he says righteous, okay, or self-righteous, that's bad. So it's got all these meanings and things, but being righteous simply means living God the way he intended you to live, not better than anybody, just on track, on point, on target. You're not perfect, you don't get it right. Everything right, that would be self-righteous, and that is bad. But righteous means, man, I'm trying my best to do what God's called me to. When I hear it, when I read it, I'm aiming for that. That's my aim, okay? So that's what righteous means as we get started. So here we are in Psalm 92. Pick up with me here. It says, the righteous, people are trying my best to do what God's called me to do. The righteous will flourish. It's a picture and a promise. Will flourish like a palm tree. They want us to think, get visual about this. They will grow, righteous people trying to do what God's called them to do. They will grow like a cedar of Lebanon. When they are planted, that means with roots. When they are planted in the house of the Lord, here's what happens when they're planted. They're not church hopping. They're not taking a vacation from church for a while. When they're planted in the house of the Lord, they will flourish in the courts of our God. Man, I can't wait to explain that. They will still bear fruit in old age. Does that say old age? Y'all must have caught that. Thank you. In old age, they will stay fresh and green. Fresh, it also meant fat. Well, it doesn't mean like a chubby tree. It meant healthy. So that's what fresh means, healthy. So I must be pretty healthy. So the psalm says if you're a righteous person, you will grow and flourish in the courts of God's house. So we learned a few things here about this verse so far, that when you are planted, when you're righteous, trying to do what God's called you to do, and you are planted in the courts of God and his temple. See, there's a temple there. And that temple of God was the center of everything. And it's saying that when we do that, we will grow, we will flourish, we will bear fruit. But what was really important was where you're planted. Where you're planted. So it's trying to get us to think that we're like a tree. We're like a tree. And the righteous will flourish. Now back then, and still today, palm trees, they have little dates on them, little fruit things I learned, and they get really tall. The palm tree can grow as tall as 90 feet. really taught means everybody can see it, and you can make drink from its sap. I learned that. It's so awesome. And you can use the leaves and things from it to make baskets and mats. It's pretty cool. So they're very valuable. But everybody can see it. They grow really fast, and they grow really, really tall. And then I read about the other one. The cedar of Lebanon is an evergreen, and it can reach as high as 120 feet. And these are the trees that they chose, we'll see in a minute, chose to put in the temple courts, the courtyard there, okay? And the thing about the cedars were they're valuable wood. That means you're valuable. The kings, rich people would say, I don't want the cheap stuff. I don't want that. I want the good stuff. So I want the cedars of Lebanon. So go way over there and get them. I don't care how much it costs, and bring it back. They're very, very valuable. So the biblical idea is that righteous people or godly people are like a tree. So they're planted in the temple courts. This is pretty significant. It was known, the temple courts in Jerusalem there was known, that's God's house, that's where he is. It's a picture of God's presence is there. And so it says that we're like a strong and healthy tree planted in the temple courts. So write this down. I got about three or four things and we'll get out of here. Number one is, when we are planted in the temple courts, when we're planted in God's house, when we're planted in church, right? Our roots are in. This is where I'm committed, man. This is where I experience God. This is where I get God's truth. Listen, we become spiritually alive. Because listen, a tree is not like a fence post. A tree is a living thing. And so they just didn't grow there naturally. They were transplanted there. Somebody picked it up and brought it and chose to put those in the temple courts. And they're not transferring dead trees. They're not transferring stumps. They're bringing something alive. And so we're not just physically alive. Listen, we're spiritually alive. The point is, when you come here, there's something that awakens in you. There's a spiritual, maybe in some cases, a resuscitation. This place brings life. And then when we're searching for righteousness and we plant ourselves here, the Bible says, this hints heavily that, hey, you're going to be spiritually alive. You can't help but be here and not be alive. And so the New Testament talks about this quite a bit. In Ephesians 2:5, Paul says this, because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions. So he's bringing us to him. And so read this next part. It says, or write it down. When we are planted in temple courts, when we decide that I've got to prioritize God's church, his house, that's where truth happens, that's where I become alive. When we're planted in temple courts, it means that God has brought us close to him. That's what happens. It means that somebody transplanted us, and it's God that did that. Ephesians 2:13, Paul says this same idea. He's talking to the non-Jews. He said, but now in Jesus Christ, you who were once far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ. So you're near. Okay? The next one is this. We're planted in the house of the temple courts. We're in a place of honor. It's an honor to be. Well, I hope you think, man, it's an honor to be at church. It's not an obligation. It's not a place that I dread, but it's a place of honor. And I started thinking about trees. And every year what they do at the White House is they have a tree. No matter who you like, if you're a donkey or an elephant, whatever your affiliation is, every year they're having a Christmas tree at the White House. And somebody is honored enough that they would ask, can we have one of your trees and you bring it here? We're going to show it off this holiday season, right? And so they bring this live tree and they put it at this very important place. And I know trees don't have feelings. You know what I'm saying? I'm not a hippie. But I bet if they did, they'd feel like, man, it's such an honor just to be here. And that's what it's like for us, man, when we view church is, man, it's an honor to be in the temple courts of the Lord. Here's the next one. When we're planted in the temple courts, we're not just bouncing around. We're not taking it seriously. Like, man, this is where I'm putting my roots down. This is where God's called me to be. When we do that, we're in a place of protection. it's safe there in the temple courts. Everything's holy there. And so somebody just can't walk up and start chopping a tree down, right? Can't do that because God's going to protect. So this is God wants to see this as a place of protection. Place of protection. Here's one more. When we're planted, it means we have roots in the temple courts, in God's church, God's house. We will produce fruit. I don't know how you can sit here very long and not experience change in your life. I think if you say, man, I'm gonna give the next year of my life to just God's house, to his church, I guarantee you in a year your life will be different. It'll be changed. And the Bible says if we do that, we will produce fruit. Even in your old age, the Bible says. In Colossians, Paul talks about bearing fruit in every good work. In Galatians 5:12, it says this. It talks about the fruit. It says the fruits are love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. We start to produce those fruits. Something changes in us when we're trying the best that we can to follow God as close as we can, and we're planted in the house of God, in the temple courts. The Bible says that we will produce fruit. So if you happen to just be waking up from a nap, I put it on one slide so you can get it, is that when we're planted in this course, planted, we become spiritually alive. When we're planted, we're close to him. When we're planted in his courts, in his house, we're in a place of honor. And we're protected and we produce fruit. When we are planted in his temple courts, in his house, at his church. So I wanted to kind of end. I knew it would go by fast for you. But the whole goal was for this series, and especially today, was, man, valuing God's house. This is your church. This is a time in all of the universe that God has opened up a place for us to gather. And it's going to be very important that we make this a stable place, a protected place, a consistent place for people that aren't experiencing those things in life to have a place to come, because God says they'll experience it here. So not just you coming, but you inviting people to it. There's people out there that are struggling just as bad, and a lot of cases worse than you or me. And they know nothing that what God's house can provide for them. And so I want us to be proud of our church in a humble, proud kind of way. Knowing that, man, when people come here, they're going to encounter God. They're going to hear his word. They have an opportunity for a changed life. And man, I'm around a lot of people in our church and hear them talk, and man, they'll tell me quite often just how much their life changed. Nothing to do with me, but about God, just being in his presence and committing to being in his presence with other believers.